Commission to order. This is a public hearing. Each case will have a public hearing, and we ask the applicant to keep their presentation to under 10 minutes. They may reserve 2 minutes as a rebuttal. So actually, it's 8 minutes, and then they can do 2 minutes later. We ask the public keep their comments to 2 minutes unless they are representing an organization or a group, and then they may have 5 minutes. And Sean there will be the gatekeeper of the time, so he will let you know. Appeals of the decisions of today, pursuant to the provisions of 2.68.030 of the Metropolitan Code of Laws, notice is hereby given that a final hearing before this commission is appealable to the Circuit Court of Certiorari, the Chancery Court of Davidson County, or the Circuit Court of Davidson County via statutory writ of certiorari. You're advised to seek your own independent legal counsel to ensure that your appeal is filed in a timely manner and that all procedural requirements are met. You should also seek independent legal advice regarding the applicability of the writ of certiorari to the specific decision of the Historic Commission. First, I'd like to get a motion to approve last month's meeting minutes.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, approval of meeting minutes. First thing is the consent agenda. Items on the consent agenda will be voted on at a single time. No individual public hearing will be held, nor will the commission debate these items unless a member of the audience or the commission requests that the item be removed from the consent agenda. And we understand that 308 Broadway has already been removed from the consent agenda.
Actually, first on the agenda is the designations, and consent will do right after that.
Okay.
So just very briefly here, the proposed overlay includes 6 properties. 4 of the buildings are historic and identified as contributing to the National Register listed in 1982. 2 are non-historic buildings. 1 of the historic buildings is First National Bank, and that was Nashville's first skyscraper in 1905. Just across the street is Noel Hotel, built in 1929. And then the overlay also includes the Romanesque-style Utopia Hotel, constructed in 1891. The hotel was one of several establishments that made up the men's quarter. In the gay 90s, men gathered in the quarter to eat, drink, and gamble in the restaurant, saloons, and the then Utopia Hotel. Climax Saloon, built in 1887, is also one of those buildings associated with the men's quarter. Again, all those properties are listed in the National Register, the Printer's Alley District. Staff recommends adopting the downtown design guidelines if the property should be designated as a local overlay by council, and to recommend to council the designation of the properties as the downtown historic preservation zoning overlay.
So we just need to approve it, debate it, open public hearing, the whole deal?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, first, are there any questions to Robin about this?
Robin, I mean, everyone knows those properties are being redeveloped. Is the owners of those properties and the developers are fine with this?
4 of them will probably be redeveloped into a hotel.
But they know about the overlay, and they have no issues about the overlay?
They are, all 6 property owners, or however many property owners there are, instigated the overlay.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Okay, thanks. Open public hearing. Is anyone that like to speak regarding this project? Regarding this overlay. Okay, seeing none, close public hearing. Discussion? Or motion?
I move approval based on staff recommendation.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, motion carries for the downtown historic preservation. Okay, the consent agenda, I think we went through the speech before, so we'll get started.
There are 6 items on the consent agenda. 1414 Eastland is a request for demolition of an existing outbuilding and construction of a detached accessory dwelling unit with a reduced rear setback. 1206 Cedar Lane is an outbuilding with reduced rear and side setbacks. 800 Setliff Place is a request for an addition that includes a ridge raise. 1507 Linden Avenue also requests an addition with a reduced side setback that will be in keeping with the home's existing side setback. 2104 Grantland Avenue is a detached accessory dwelling unit with a reduced rear setback. 308 Broadway has been removed from the consent agenda. 1408 Woodland Street requests an addition and alterations to an existing outbuilding proposed as a detached accessory dwelling unit. Staff recommends approval of all consent agenda items with their applicable conditions, finding them to meet the design guidelines.
Okay. First, since you're a different face, could you introduce yourself to the group?
Hi, I'm Susan Steffenhagen. I'm an intern this summer.
All right, thank you. Welcome. Any questions about the consent agenda?
I have one quick one.
Yep.
If we could go back to the one that has the ridge raise. I don't think have we not ever done that before?
Yes, that ridge raise is something that the Historic Commission came up with way before your time. Mm-hmm. It was a way to allow for additional height in upper stories that may be almost usable but not quite have enough headroom. And the exact configuration of how that would work is in our design guidelines, and this project does follow all that.
Okay, so we're not in danger of a dangerous precedent.
No, we are not. Okay. Thank you for checking.
Okay, thank you. Open public hearing. Any discussions about any of the items on the consent agenda? Okay, seeing none, closed public hearing. Discussion or motion?
Move to approve. Second.
Okay, have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, the consent agenda is approved. First one on the list is 308 Broadway.
This photo here shows 308 and 310 Broadway. 308 on the left of that picture was built in 2011. It's a commercial structure. It was meant to look like a two-story building with retail on the first story, and the upper story is really just a front and partial side facade without roof or windows. And the proposal is to finish out the second story and then to add a rooftop addition above that. The second story in those openings will be installed paired double-hung windows. Those could be casements with the appearance of double-hung windows. Staff finds that these windows would be appropriate, but the paired windows should have mullions between them, as is typical of traditional double-hung windows, and also the window pane should be offset like traditional double-hung windows. The rooftop addition in the rendering there on the right will be set back 37 feet from the front parapet with an uncovered roof deck in front of the addition but behind the parapet. The front-facing wall of the addition will have roll-up overhead doors with wood siding above. Those materials wrap around, there's the front elevation there. The materials wrap around to the left side where the primary material on the sidewall of the addition. Below that will be brick matching the existing one and a half story wall. Staff finds that the wood siding would be appropriate on the front only, and that's essentially because it's an interior wall space there, set back behind the parapet. But the wood siding is not appropriate for the side wall, as all of the buildings downtown are brick, in the overlay, are brick. So here, too, a masonry wall would be appropriate. Likewise, staff finds that the window pattern on the front facade of the addition, the roll-up garage door type openings, is appropriate on the front, but not on the side here, which faces an alley. Typically, windows on exterior elevations like this are twice as tall as they are wide, with alternating sections of solid wall and void. With those materials being conditioned, staff recommends approval of the second story build out and window installation and the construction of a rooftop addition at 308/310 Broadway, with the conditions that staff approves the brick color or brick sample and the roof color, that the new second story windows have the true had the appearance of true double-hung windows, including offset sashes and mullions between pairs. That the left side wall be brick with wood siding on the roof deck facing elevations only, and that the window type and window proportion on the left side wall be consistent with upper story windows of historic buildings. Meeting those conditions, staff finds that the proposal meets the design guidelines for the Broadway Historic Preservation Overlay.
Okay, thanks, Sean. Any questions for Sean?
Just curious, how was the permit, what was permitted to build on in that, for that structure now? I mean, originally?
In 2011. The guidelines require buildings to be at least 30 feet tall. I think this candy kitchen only wanted one story, so they were required to build the second wall. It's all original to the 4 years ago to sort of meet that minimum of the guidelines with the potential to build it out later.
Sean, real quick, I'm trying to place myself on this spot on Broadway. Did this used to be a sports bar?
No, there's a similar building up on the 400 block, Bailey's. That has that false kind of the Hollywood wall. Or, you know,
so was this a place that used to be called Savannah's Kitchen? I mean,
actually,
they made candy or something?
It was a parking lot for... well, not always, but at least from whenever the building that once was there got demolished until 2011, it was a parking lot with a hot dog cart that sold.
Right. I remember, yeah.
T-shirts,
I've been there.
Probably.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks, Sean.
There's an applicant here, too, who wished to speak.
Would the applicant like to come forward and state your name and address?
My name is John Tissell. I'm the architect working with the owner for this project. Just wanted to sort of, I guess, present a case regarding three of the recommendations. I think all those recommendations we are, you know, certainly happy to comply with and think they are applicable here. The three that I wanted to address in my comments are, one, the dividers or the mullions specified in between these French casement windows. The second is the use of the roll-up doors and the wood siding on the alley side of the third floor addition. I think for all these situations, for all these points, I mean, there are some unique aspects to this property that, although a strict reading of the guidelines may say those things would not be appropriate here, I think that there are unique features of this property that make those, should make those acceptable, and that would not set a precedent for other properties in the district, because this is a unique property in that way. I mean, I think the first thing that's quite unusual about this property is that we are building on top of an existing new building. So it's a sort of an unusual situation, but it is a new building, and we're building a new building on top of a new building. We're not modifying the existing 308 Broadway in any way on the exterior. So we're not changing the actual historic context. We are changing a non-historic building, so to speak. If we go back to the first, could we go back to the very first image that showed the photograph? That one there. You see the building on the farthest left of this, which I guess is 312. That actually has quite large openings there in the masonry. I mean, they've been infilled, obviously, with something, and a single double-hung window's put in there, but those are quite large openings. And so the immediate context of this building is a little bit different. Certainly one side has these individual tall double-hung windows. The other side has much more like a square opening in a masonry wall. And then what we're dealing with as a sort of starting point for the second floor of this candy kitchen building is kind of somewhere in between. I mean, they are kind of tall openings. They're not quite the size of either on the either side, so it's somewhere in between. And as we look at, if we go to the elevations, could we switch to the front elevation view, please? That one there, you can see down there on the second level of the candy kitchen building, if we were to insert a 6-inch mullion in between those panes of the French casement windows, they'd each get extremely skinny. And I think they would be sort of out of scale then with the other windows. If you compare the proportion of one of those, quote, double-hung windows that we're putting in to the double-hung window next door, the proportion's about the same. If we were to squeeze in a 6-inch mullion, it would get kind of small. And so Not to mention, it wouldn't work as well. I mean, the idea is for the owner, they want to be able to open these out, make it more open to the street. Certainly when they're closed, they'd look like double hungs, but when they function as French casement windows. So of course, putting mullion in there would make that not work, but I think also it wouldn't really achieve the look that we're trying to, the consistency of down the street, because we'd be making these windows extremely skinny and tall, which is kind of out of character for buildings in this district. So that would be my point about inserting that mullion there. If we go further down on these slides, I think there are some simulated views.
Can I ask a question real
fast?
Sean, your recommendation on those mullions, is it to split each of those panes in two, or?
If they are to be pairs, typically double hung windows would have a mullion between. They could also be just single double hung windows. They don't have to be paired inside the opening.
And the reason for the pairing is to open them out?
Right. I mean, the idea was to be able to, you couldn't, I guess it's two. Those are pretty big openings, actually. So you couldn't make one of those swing in that way. I think if you made that a single double hung window, to me that would look the most odd of anything, because that would really not have that vertical proportion at all. It would be, those openings are sort of what we're sort of working with what we had there, but that was what was approved when this building was built. And they are kind of somewhere in between the 308 building, what it has, and then what the 312 building has. And so in a way they're both context, and we're kind of working with being somewhere in the middle of that context.
If I could make a recommendation, he's actually in his timed presentation, so maybe we should just let him finish and then discuss after, if that's okay.
Okay. Could we switch ahead to the perspective views, if that's, or go ahead one more. Do you have?
They're in the staff recommendations.
Okay.
They're not all in the slide.
Okay. In the packet, then, let me see if I can switch ahead to that one so we can be on the same sheet here. You can see, I've got them here. It's this view sort of from the ground, which is from across Broadway, and then the next page, which is also from across Broadway. And in that, we have the sort of adjacent buildings kind of blocked in there as context. And you can see, this is a very narrow alley. That's about a 10-foot alley in between here. And it's a dead-end alley. Nobody walks down there. It's used for service access only. And so, really, this is not very visible. I mean, if you're standing across Broadway looking down that alley, that's the most you're ever going to see of this. So it's, although it is technically a public facade, it's very different than a public facade facing Broadway or facing Third or whatever. And so in that way, I'd say it's quite not visible. I mean, you can hardly see what's going on down there at all. But to the extent that you can see it, again, I would make the case that this is a new addition to a new building. And as such, I think that there's a somewhat different standard that it should be held to. Certainly in the wider context of up and down Broadway, not every opening is full height. Some of the newer buildings, the one that used to be the furniture store across the street, or another one further up Broadway, do have more horizontal openings. Those are newer buildings. Some built in the 50s, built in the 30s. Certainly not the same age as some of the older buildings on Broadway, but this one's also not the same age. And so in that way, I'm saying, if you look at the broader context of all of Broadway, the age of all the buildings there, what was appropriate for the different times in which they were built, given that this is a modern building, I think it's not completely out of the question to say, why not have built the windows look a little modern, especially on the part that's most recessed from the street, least visible, and in a way that it sort of gives a little more integrity, I guess, on that roof deck, and that this thing is a little unit that sits up there, and to sort of say, oh, well, we're going to have garage doors on part of it, but then the other side we're going to have these historic-looking windows, seems to me, in totality, kind of less have less architectural integrity than to say, let's accept the whole thing as a new building and allow it to have new windows. Again, it's a unique situation, I think, because it is a unique building, and that side facade is not very visible. No one walks down there. No one looks up and sees it for the most part. It's more going to be experienced from the inside or from the roof deck. So those are the three points I'd make, I guess, the dividers between the windows and not having those, I think, actually matches the proportion of windows better. And then the use of the roll-up garage doors on that upper level on the side and of the non-masonry siding above the reclaimed wood up above that, again, sort of calling that out as a newer piece of construction that, although not appropriate, perhaps, or not matching, perhaps, the 19th century masonry construction, is not out of character with the larger scope of Broadway, where some different materials have been used over the years on newer buildings.
Okay, thanks, John.
Sure.
Do you have any questions for the applicant?
I have one quick one. What's the use for this? What's going to be the use for this addition?
Oh, the whole building is a restaurant. So all of 308, all three levels of 308 would be the restaurant, and then the bottom level of 310 would remain the candy store. But then the upper two levels would be connected to 308, and they would be part of the restaurant as well.
So no residential in here at all?
No.
Okay.
No.
Thanks.
Anything else to the applicant?
Okay.
Thanks, John.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, open public hearing. Would anyone like to speak regarding this project? Okay, seeing none, closed public hearing. Discussion?
When I first look at this, the applicant, John, kind of, I think, hit exactly what I was thinking, not recognizing how new and or old, I mean, when you do a closer examination, this looks a little, looks like it's trying to fit in, but it certainly is not, 100 plus year old construction. So it really is a weird sort of situation where you've got something new that kind of wants to look old, and then you're putting a new addition on it that definitely wants to be a different thing. And I think history will judge us on these, spaceships that have landed on some of the historic buildings downtown and the use that is going on now that may not, 100 years from now may not continue to be that use, or maybe all the buildings will be converted to then by that time. But rather than facading this building to, okay, the front's this and the side's this, I think considering the building and it's altogether three-dimensionally, it makes more sense that there's a building with a thing on top of it than it is there's a facade, and then over here this facade should look a little different because this is historically the way it was treated, just form and massing wise, without specific particular attention to would this opening be appropriate within this particular view. I guess that makes a little more sense to me architecturally, and the fact that it's set not quite at 50% back, but well back from the front facade of the building, and that it is, it's a thing on the roof, kind of is what it reads as to me. And the more that can read a thing on the roof that is not of or trying to be a historic building, in my opinion, the better in this situation.
What do you think about the mullions?
And I think the garage doors and the mullions are purely a function of use and a restaurateur and owner's desire to, let it all hang out, let the good times roll. Architecturally, I'm not nearly as sensitive to the owner's desire to do that as it being appropriate, but I think the applicant brings up a good point that if you were to look at this and have it drawn with a 6-inch mullion, it starts to approach something that I think, I'd want to look and see if there were another example of that really tall one, greater than a 1-to-4 proportion given the size of these is not a very common thing, and it might look more odd than kind of go away. And I think in this case, if I'm not advocating for doing away with what traditionally you can see. If you've got paired windows all the way up Broadway, there is, in fact, a mullion historically in those buildings. They were framed with a thick mullion between them. In this case, because of what they're dealing with, it's not, they're infilling an opening that we kind of got to work with. I wonder if it would look more odd than without. I don't know that I can tie that back to the guidelines other than just a general appearance.
Thank you.
Well, I appreciate staff's recommendation on this, and I think is the right comments relative to sort of the strict interpretation of our guidelines. At the same time, I have a hard time disagreeing with any of the comments of the architect, in that I do think a 6-inch mullion might make those windows start to feel out of proportion with what's historically along the Broadway streetscape. I wonder I'm not sure what type of windows are going to be used, but if these are custom windows anyways, if there's a way to give a little more thickness to the inside, if these are casements, maybe there's a way to provide more thickness to, one of the casements that gives that appearance when it's closed, to having a little more thickness without going to 6 inches plus the frame, plus the sash, which I think will start to make these windows too narrow. And then again, I think up on the roof, and I think I'm agreeing with what Ben was saying, that, this is, when I heard the staff recommendation of only having the wood on the front, it made me think about us looking at these things in two dimensions and having one material on one side of a form and another material on the other side of a form. Architecturally usually isn't sort of doesn't ha- typically is you want to have the same material sort of wrapping a corner, so I was concerned about us sort of treating it like brick slapped on the front of a siding house, and how that looks, thinking about it just two-dimensionally and not three-dimensionally. So given that it's set back as far as it is, that while this is, if this was a street corner versus a 10-foot alley corner, I might think differently about how this whole rooftop addition should respond to the street. But I tend to agree with the architect's statement that this is a unique condition. It's not a historic building. It's an existing building. The openings were given. The rooftop addition is set back, I think, from Broadway. Visually, there's very little, if any, impact to the street with what's proposed. So, I don't know where I'll fall on each condition at the end of the day, but I think the request of the architect is relatively reasonable. While I certainly see that the staff's recommendation is a strict interpretation of our guidelines.
May I throw in a request on this one, in terms of the garage doors? This is something that many, many, many businesses have asked for. And I'm very concerned that if those are approved on the side, that it will open some doors for us to approve them elsewhere. And where is that line? There are two buildings across the street that, aren't on mid-block alleys, but are next to small parking lots where a building should be but isn't. Are we going to allow garage doors there? There's so many requests, both on Broadway and Second. This is such an anomaly for a historic district. I would, caution you to look at that pretty carefully. And if you do approve it, to give us some pretty clear guidance.
Robin, sorry, I didn't print out the staff report. So can you clarify again, is it all of the garage doors that staff's concerned about?
Just the ones on the sidewall.
On the side of the historic building.
It's not a historic building. It's later construction. But even if that was a vacant lot.
On the alley, I think, are the ones that.
Yes.
Yeah.
On the alley. Oh, okay.
Not the ones facing the rooftop deck.
So, okay, so those are garage doors as well, even though they just come down to like a windowsill height. So they roll up.
But how are they set back on the alley side? Or do they even roll up on the alley side?
They do, yes.
And there's not setback at all, according to this.
Correct.
What I'm looking at, okay.
And that's why, the ones that are set back, we could see an argument for, but allowing them on new construction, historic buildings, any buildings at all, downtown on the front and sides, we're very concerned about.
Okay. That was going to be, I think, my comment was to probably stick with staff recommendations, particularly on the rolling door. On the historic building, is that correct? Are they at? No, this one on the.
They're making
the taller one, right?
Yeah, they're not making any changes to the front of the historic building.
But putting the rolling doors on the side of that, that's a problem for you, right?
No, because that is on that upper level. It was really the side of the new construction.
Oh, okay.
It's only on the alley.
Yeah. Only on the alley.
So this is quite the dilemma, because we're... I agree with Ben. The architect worked with what he had. This is not a historic building. It is in our historic district. And I think I've said on this commission several times that I am for allowing historic structures to evolve. I don't have a problem with the side garage doors on the alley, except that I think they could be dangerous. We had a young man fall off of a building within the last year on Broadway, off of one of the porches or decks that we did not approve that they built anyway. In the same breath, that same intervention on that building could bring new life to that small nothing of an alley, which our city is beginning to do. We've done it on Printer's Alley. Other cities are doing it, so I'm afraid I'm caught in the middle here.
I do have a question, just to clarify. So we're talking about the roll-ups garage on the alley side, but you're okay with the roll-ups on the front side facade?
Because they are set back from the front of the building.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And how about the ones that are on the historic building side?
Again, because those are facing, they're set back and facing that rooftop.
How far are they set back?
I don't remember off the top of my head.
37 feet.
Printer's Alley is a good example. Roll-up doors are there because that is the rear alley. That is a service alley, and they're approved on the first level. But I don't know of any on upper levels. I don't like to jump in here and debate with you, but very, very concerned about that and about where that leads us for new construction, existing buildings, but mainly new construction.
From my perspective about all of this is, and giving due consideration, Robin, to your request to make a distinction, I think it can be made in this case because it's just a 10-foot alley. You can't really see this from Broadway. And it's the front that we're really concerned about here. It would be the side if you could really see it, but you can't. So I'm inclined to make a distinction based on that. It's a 10-foot alley. It's blocked there. So I think from a practical consideration, we can make a distinction fairly simply in this particular case from others that might come before you that don't have this barrier. So if that helps to give you some kind of distinction, I can see one being drawn here in this particular case with this particular application.
Can I, one more thing on that too? Thank you, Commissioner. I guess my caution is because it's a historic overlay that we do have stricter guidelines on it versus a conservation overlay. So, you know, I think we can make some precedents on that and people will start coming to the board to ask for those kind of exceptions, even if you can't see it. I mean, if I recall another project that we did, we couldn't see it, but I think because it's a historic overlay, you know, we're more discerned about those kind of details.
Have we seen, if you guys can help me out, have we seen another project like this maybe a year ago that was closer to the corner of Broadway and 2nd that wanted to do a corner roof and they wanted to do a garage door like this? And I can't remember what we decided for the life of me.
The ones that were facing the open, like this one, the ones that were facing the open rooftop area were approved, and ones on the sides have never been approved.
Okay.
Whether it was new or old.
Okay.
Along those lines, Robin, and I guess for in staff's opinion and view of that is that on the public way is, they all may be less desirable in the staff's view, but on the public way, there is a distinction between being on the public way and a facade that might, if two buildings were owned or there were rights to a roof, where you come out of the side of the building onto kind of a rooftop level is maybe, there's a distinction between those two conditions in the staff's view. Is that what I'm hearing?
I'm not sure I followed the question.
Well, I'll tell you, this application, for example, there are garage doors that face on a side facade of a non-public, you know, on something that doesn't front the public way. And that seems to be different and distinct from something that, even however small it might be, does front a public way. There is a definite distinction there in the staff's opinion.
Definitely, and we did look at the alley as a public right of way, and the one that I think you had asked about, that corner lot, it was a similar situation where there were garage doors coming out of the building next door, the historic building next door, onto the rooftop, and those were approved. And of course, garage doors on the front facade of the rooftop addition were approved. But again, nothing on the sides or fronts have ever been approved.
Based on that, my inclination would be to stick with what Robin suggested on the side, that one side. I mean, we're going to theoretically, maybe it's possible he gets garage doors on the front and that side of that one building. That seems pretty nice.
Okay. Sean, can you please show us the elevation or perspective or the bird's eye view, whatever you want to call it? So there's absolutely no setback there whatsoever?
No, it's essentially an extension of the wall below, carrying up.
Yeah. But it does, it's operable, it opens, right? Or it would?
I believe so.
Okay.
If the windows were fixed, would there be a different if we weren't proposing that proportion of opening and mullions, would there be an objection to architecturally to that on that facade, just out of curiosity?
Again, our recommendation was for something that was more like a punched opening, which is what the guidelines call for new construction.
Well, we vetted it through. Anyone want to? It seems like we were kind of talking about the mullions. Maybe we were okay with that, but anyway, anyone might want to make a recommendation?
Not quite a recommendation yet, but I mean, I think in making sure that we're sticking to the guidelines, or at least if we're doing that, I think in F2, you know, masonry materials are primarily used in the district and should continue to be predominant. In my mind, both what's existing and then they're adding that much more again to it certainly reads as predominant in taking these issues one by one. I think, I mean, the wood as an accent, I don't know if wood's necessarily a contemporary material, but they may be used if they possess characteristics similar in scale, design, finish, texture, and durability to historic materials. That would be the litmus test for whether the wood siding would wrap there, and I think could be approved in this situation. The windows and the mullions on the front, I feel like is a rhythm and proportion issue. Even if there was a way to, I think you'd go a long way to try and adjust that. And then once you open it up, it's kind of like the fakery is sort of revealed once the transoms are opened, if that is in fact how those windows operate, that it might be do well to just leave that one alone if we're not going to require a mullion and proper and I would question whether proportionally those windows would look correct, and perhaps Yeah, I don't know if we'd give some guidance or see a drawing of such, but that the mullions don't necessarily. I would be very worried about the proportion and the rhythm of openings if we were to add a 6-inch mullion there. And I'm kind of hung up on the garage doors, on the alley facade, on the public facade. I certainly understand staff's concern there.
I agree with Ben wholeheartedly about, you know, Broadway is a melting pot of architecture. I do like the modern flair that this addition has. What is hanging me up is the garage doors on the alley side with no setback, and it doesn't appear to show a railing. You know, it's very technical with me. We had a young man fall off a balcony. I don't even know the name of the building. It's 3rd and Broadway or 4th and Broadway. It's a honky-tonk. It 37 feet is one thing. You can't see it from the road, and it's nice and safe, but to be on a sheer facade like that and be opened up,
if the scale figures are accurate, it appears the parapet is to be treated kind of as railing. It may not be necessary there to meet and or exceed what the code requirement would be.
Let's see how we.
Yep.
Okay. But that is correct. I mean, the parapet's 4 feet high, including where the garage doors are shown. So,
yeah. It's a good rate. And while I appreciate your concern, Sam, you know, we've got codes and all that should take care of any of those safety, you know, requirements and needs. And, you know, beyond that, you know, it's not really, I don't think it's really our purview to consider those safety issues related to the architecture.
Okay, well, now I'll say this then, on the other half of my brain, if we do have a 4-foot parapet, I think that the side garage doors will be a welcome addition to this alley that could become something else someday, instead of just an alley with a few dumpsters along it. It's like setting a chessboard for what may or may not happen someday. And that's my last comment. I think.
So does anyone want to start a motion?
I'll start one.
Okay.
Move approval based on some of staff recommendations. That being the that the garage doors not be allowed on the alley, and that I think I am waiving all the other requirements, so that the wood would wrap around in the alley. The garage doors would be on the front and the side of the other building, and that the casement windows would remain as drawn, as presented.
And that staff approve brick roof color.
And staff would approve the
brick sample
color.
Okay. Do I have a motion? Do I have a second?
I second.
Okay. Discussion?
Would I think the applicant, without the garage doors, may require some approval of something, some alternate, and it sounds like the staff just doing that pattern in a fixed window is not acceptable. So unless we don't want to have the applicant come back, if it pleases those making the motion, if we could maybe give a little bit of guidance, or they can come back, that would be something
well,
worth.
I think we could, unless you would want more guidance, can we just? Upon staff approval of the side windows?
Well, I would like to double check if I could. The motion was based on the conditions of staff approving the roof color and brick sample.
did you include the second story windows have the appearance of a double hung window with offset sashes and mullions?
His motion was to approve as submitted, as proof as drawn, not approving that recommendation. Is that what you're...
Well, that's different from the mullions. I know there's a lot of discussion about mullions.
Okay. We were willing to do the offset. That's not a problem, for what it's worth.
Okay, it'll be including the...
Yeah, I've been operating, and been paying very close attention. We don't have a detail of what the window looks like. I'm getting now that it was just a mullion transom that didn't appear as a true casement. I would think that would be appropriate. Yeah, and that noting that while normally we would see a center mullion divider historically, and we would hope to see that in future cases, that the size of this opening and the resulting size of windows would not be in keeping. I think that this not be carte blanche to not, you don't have to do mullions because of this case is certainly not what we're intending here.
Maybe it is including that one, that staff recommendation for the casement detail?
Why don't I read back what I have and then see if you and Commissioner Bell agree that this is what you meant. Commissioner Fletcher moved to approve with the conditions that staff approves the roof color and a brick sample. The new second story windows have the appearance of double hung windows, including offset sashes and mullions, and that the garage doors not be allowed on the side elevation.
Not one of the recommendations was not for it to wrap. Allow the wood to wrap and would allow the garage doors on the front and then also on the side of the other building, but not the alley, right.
And you're okay?
With that motion?
Yes.
Yeah. Discussion, so you go ahead.
Yeah.
I guess when I heard the motion originally, it was to essentially strike the second condition, basically approving the windows as proposed. I think what I heard, or I'm hearing among the commissioners, and based on what the applicant has said, that if we eliminated the mullion requirement from that second condition, yet kept the requirement for the offset sash.
Right. That's what's in the motion now.
That's not.
You're correct. I did say that. I did not mean to say that.
You kept the mullion in there, but
just to be clear, let me say it one more time.
Okay.
So we all know. Commissioner Fletcher moved to approve with the conditions that staff approves the roof color and brick sample. The new second story windows have the appearance of double hung windows, including offset sashes, and the garage doors not be allowed on the alley side elevation.
So the mullions is not in there. I feel like I need to interject here, and just for purposes of the record, is that your motion, and is that your second?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Any more discussion?
I guess just for clarification and for the applicant's sake, assuming the applicant comes back with a solution on the alley side that, in staff's opinion, meets the design guidelines, will he have to come back before the commission?
We'll leave that up to what we receive, but if it's something we feel absolutely meets the guidelines, we can just do that administratively and they can keep moving. If we still think there's still uncomfortable with it, it might come back to you, but I kind of doubt it.
Okay. So this is an approval and sort of the...
Keep moving.
Yeah. Okay, great.
Okay, we have a motion, second, and discussion. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, motion carries. All right, the next one is the first one on the list, right? 1115 Lillian Street.
1115 Lillian Street is an application to demolish a non-contributing house and construct new infill. The infill will be 1.5 stories in height and will be approximately 30 feet tall. Here is the site plan. The house meets all base zoning requirements. The house does not the house does include an attached carport at the rear on the ground floor level. While the commission does not typically approve attached carports at the ground floor, staff finds this carport to be acceptable because of the shallowness of the lot, the lack of an alley for the site, and the lack of immediate historic context on this block. The commission did approve a similar attached carport next door at 113 Lillian Street in January 2015, and you can see that that's the structure that's outlined to the left. Staff does ask, as a condition of approval, that the depth of the front porch at the front of the house be increased from 5 feet to 6 feet to be in keeping with the commission's past decisions regarding usable front porches. We just feel that 6 feet is the minimum that you can have to have a usable and significant front porch. You can see on the left, there's a photograph of the house that the commission approved in January 2015. It has many similar features to what is before you today. It's not quite finished, but enough of the construction, I think, is finished for you to get an idea. On the right is the photo of the existing structure that the applicant is proposing to be demolished, and it is a structure we consider to be non-contributing. Here are the side elevations. The applicant is proposing materials that the commission has approved in the past on many other structures. And finally, here is the rear elevation. So in conclusion, staff recommends approval of the demolition and the construction of the new infill with the following conditions. The finished floor height be consistent with the finished floor heights of the adjacent houses to be verified by MHDC staff in the field. 2, the porch be a minimum of 6 feet deep along the front facade. And finally, 3, staff approve the windows and doors, HVAC location, and roof color. I think the applicant is here, and I'm happy to answer any questions before he comes up.
Okay, any questions for Melissa? All right, thanks. Okay. Would the applicant like to come forward and state your name and address?
Hi, my name is John Root. I'm the architect for the project. I agree with all the staff recommendations. I would just caution about the 6-foot requirement. The reason why we went to a 5-foot, we felt 5-foot was the minimum depth we needed. As you can see on the picture on the left, the grade does get severe the closer you get to Lillian Street. So we were trying to make that, every foot you come closer to the street, it's almost a 1-to-1 slope at some point. So we were trying to maintain the finished floor elevation of the adjacent home. We were trying to match that and thereby create a kind of a valley down the driveways to create the water flow. So that was the purpose for the 5-foot. So I agree with all the other recommendations for staff.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions to applicant? Thanks. Open public hearing. Would anyone like to speak regarding this project? Okay. Close public hearing. Discussion.
So the street elevation that's in the package doesn't appear to reflect the grades necessarily. Is that because it does, or is this approximately what it would look like with the slope in the front yard? Do we know? Or maybe I can ask that. I should have to ask the applicant.
The only one that's probably not shown correctly is right there at the porch. We're trying to push the dirt back up on the house as much as possible. Looking at the house next door is probably a better example. We're trying to get three blocks exposed. I think that's what kind of we're pushing for. Mm-hmm. Obviously, landscaping will help kind of conceal that a little bit.
Okay, thanks. And then it looks like there's room potentially to slide the building back a foot or so if necessary in order to let a 6-foot porch kind of meet the proper foundation height. Is that right, Robin, that there's, would the staff, I know it looks like it aligns with one of the existing buildings, but would the staff be opposed if the building slid back a foot or two, if the 6-foot porch presents a challenge relative to the finished floor elevation and the foundation height. There's room to do that.
Yeah, I think they could almost go with it. On this block, there really are no historic structures, so there's probably more flexibility here than there would be on other blocks. So I think they have the option of either adding a foot to that front porch or shifting everything back 1 foot. Either would be appropriate in this instance.
I guess since the way we're working, you good with that? Okay. Okay. All right. On to roll with it.
So I think then I'll move we approve staff recommendation.
I guess we should. Should we bring up about moving the foot or? Oh, gotcha. I'm sorry. Okay.
Yeah, my motion still includes the 6 foot porch.
Yeah.
And I think the record will reflect our conversation that there's some flexibility in the siding of the house.
Okay, we got a motion. All right, got a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Okay, motion carries. Thank you. I think that is it for the agenda. Is there anything else?
I just want to apologize for not introducing Susan myself. We're so pleased she's been here to work with us over the last few months. She's been primarily working on a project for the Nashville City Cemetery, but also getting involved in other aspects of the commission. And thank you so much for helping us.
And today is her birthday.
Oh. Also,
great job presenting.
And Melissa, is this your Melissa, is this your first meeting back?
No.
Okay. Okay. Sorry. I know. Maybe it's my first meeting back. Sorry.
All right. Motion. Meeting adjourned.